Second reading today is from Luke, chapter 9, verses 28 to 43. And today is Transfiguration Sunday, even though I'm preaching about James. So the verses we're reading now in Luke concerning the Transfiguration. About 8 days after Jesus said these things, he took Peter, John, and James, and went up on a mountain to pray. While Jesus was praying, the appearance of his face changed, and his clothes became shining white. Then two men, Moses and Elijah, were talking with Jesus. They appeared in heavenly glory, talking about his departure, which he would soon bring about in Jerusalem. Peter and the others were very sleepy, but when they awoke fully, they saw the glory of Jesus and the two men standing with them. When Moses and Elijah were about to leave, Peter said to Jesus, "Master, it is good that we are here. Let us make three tents, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." Peter did not know what he was talking about. While he was saying these things, a cloud came and covered them, and they were afraid as the cloud covered them. A voice came from the cloud saying, "This is my son, whom I have chosen. Listen to him." When the voice finished speaking, only Jesus was there. Peter, John, and James said nothing and told no one at that time what they had seen. The next day, when they came down from the mountain, a large crowd met Jesus. A man in the crowd shouted to him, "Teacher, please come and look at my son, because he is my only child. An evil spirit seizes my son, and suddenly he screams. It causes him to lose control of himself and foam at the mouth. The evil spirit keeps on hurting him and almost never leaves him. I begged your followers to force the evil spirit out, but they could not do it." Jesus answered, "You people have no faith, and your lives are all wrong. How long must I stay with you and put up with you? Bring your son here." While the boy was coming, the demon threw him to the ground and made him lose control of himself. But Jesus gave a strong command to the evil spirit and healed the boy and gave him back to his father. All the people were amazed at the great power of God. Okay. Well, today we're going to try to get through the rest of James, so we can get back on track. This week we have Ash Wednesday on Wednesday, of course, and then we're starting into the Lent season. So we want to get, I want to get on track with all of the things we need to be talking about through the Lent season. So we're trying to wrap up James, so we're going to move fairly quickly. So I won't give you a whole lot of history today, like I have been doing today. So for those of you that don't really like history, today is your lucky day. We're not going to talk so much about history. One of the things we do want to remember as we're thinking about the book of James and we're reading the book of James again is that the big things that James is trying to get across to us is this thing about being double-minded. Again, we talked about that before, doing one thing and acting it, or saying one thing and acting another way. And this is very much the message that Jesus brought to us was this, when he confronted the Pharisees. Have to remember, we talked about this in Sunday school today and at different times, but when he confronted the Pharisees, one of the big things he was doing when he confronted them was about the Pharisees saying one thing and doing another. This potential to be a hypocrite. Now, the sad thing is that if all of us looked at our lives, I'm certain that we could all find at least one aspect of something where we are a hypocrite. Okay? And as I was talking in Sunday school this morning, one of those things that in my life I've tried hard to examine my various behaviors and beliefs and things like that and try not to be a hypocrite. Now, I will confess, you know, one of the areas that I can slip and be a hypocrite is in swearing, okay? Now, if someone were to meet me now that knew me 40 years ago, or 30 years ago, or 25 years ago, when my wife and I became, when we were married, one of the biggest things that would be surprised is that Roy doesn't swear much anymore. Well, there's a reason for that. You see, my lovely wife despises cursing and swearing, and she's managed to tame me and beat that behavior out of me over the years. So it's all, I can't say that it was the goodness of my heart that I stopped being like that. It was more that I was retrained by my lovely wife. who really despises cursing and swearing. But once in a while, I will confess, I slip up and I'll say something, and usually my wife will immediately point it out to me that I've said something bad. And if it happens to be a vulgarity and not a curse word, I'll point out to her that that's not actually taking the Lord's name in vain, that's just a vulgarity. And that doesn't get me very far. Men would realize that when you're debating. So at any rate, it's not a good thing. It's not something I'm proud of at all. But it is just something that unfortunately, it's the thing that sometimes I mess up on. And in reality, it's a bit of a hypocrisy. Here I am as a pastor, and though I will tell you, I've known some pastors that swore a lot more than I did. But that's neither here nor there. But with that, we're going to jump into James. We're in the fourth chapter now. We're trying to try to get through chapter 4 and 5 in one quick sitting here. Hopefully it won't be a 30-minute sermon, Lonnie. I know Lonnie gave me, is accusing me of going long here. But, those conflicts and dispute among you, where do they come from? Do they not come from your cravings that are at war within you? You want something and you do not have it, so you commit murder. And you covet something and cannot obtain it, so you engage in disputes and conflicts. You do not have because you do not ask. You ask and do not receive because you ask wrongly, in order to spend what you get on your pleasures. Adulterers, do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Therefore, whoever wishes to be a friend of the world becomes an enemy of God. We knew that, don't we? We want things, but we want things for selfish reasons. And this is, again, this double-mindedness, this idea that we're focused on God, yet when we're praying, and asking for something because it's something that benefits us. We need to keep in mind that when we're praying, you know, one of the more interesting quotes that I have comes from Arnold Schwarzenegger, of all people. And he's not necessarily looked upon as being the most pious guy, but I remember a quote from back when I was young. Somebody was interviewing Schwarzenegger, and you all know he was Mr. Universe, Mr. Yes, Mr. Olympia seven times, the best bodybuilder in the world. And somebody was interviewing him and said to him, "Arnold, you pray to win the Mr. Olympia." And he said to the reporter, "God has more important things to worry about than whether I win the Olympia." And I think that's a great way of looking. Yes, he's worked very hard and he devotes a lot of his energies towards that. But the idea is that he's not praying to God about that because this is something he wants for something that's selfish. And to pray, I should be praying for things that are magnanimous, something that helps others, not something that's a selfish thing. I don't think that by saying that, I don't want you to think that I'm saying we shouldn't try to be successful, we shouldn't try to be the best that we can be. I'm not saying that at all, because we try to be successful, but we try to use that success as Christians to better help others, for better witness. We need to use it in a positive way. We need to have the right spirit and not be double-minded about when we're trying, what we want out of life or what we want from God. We need to make sure that what we want is something that's on the same track as God. That is something that God is in God's grand plan. It sort of ties in with something that's later on here about when you go to another town. We'll get to that as we come to that. We'll skip ahead a little bit. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. So draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. We talked earlier about temptations and things like that in James, about where do those come from. And I maintain that most of those temptations actually come from your heart. They're not coming from outside, they're coming from within. And that I've said before, and I'm sure I said it during this sermon series, that if you want to see Satan, the best place to see Satan is to look in the mirror. Because we all have some issue of darkness in our spirits. So that's just part of who we are. We unfortunately have those two wolves that I've talked about before battling. We need to feed the good wolf. And by we feed that good wolf by drawing near to God. By being with God's people, that's being in fellowship with one another, hearing the word, just spending time with good people. You are who you associate with, as they say. Let us associate with God. Now, we come into this about what I was talking about. Come now, you who say today or tomorrow you will go to such and such a town and spend a year there doing business and making money. Yet you do not even know what tomorrow will bring. What is your life? For you are a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes. Instead, you ought to say, if the Lord wishes, we will live and do this or that. As it is, you boast in your arrogance. All such boasting is evil. Anyone then who knows the right thing to do and fails to do it commits sin. That's back to that whole thing about we were talking about clarity. We're asking for the wrong thing. We need to ask. We want our intentions and our desires and our goals to be in line with what God wants. We need to pray. We are prayerful for guidance and for insight and direction. And I'm a firm believer that if we do continuously pray, that eventually that insight, that guidance will show up. It'll get there when the time is right. But we talk about that here next. He talks about, be patient, therefore, beloved, until the coming of the Lord. He talks about the farmer. All of that's talking about the patience, having our mind in the right place, not being double-minded, focusing on what God's plan is, and being patient and being in prayer. Waiting and watching. And that is so terribly difficult. That's probably one of the most difficult things that anyone can ask someone to do, is to be patient for things. And as I talked to the children, very much so when I was trying to find a pulpit, I was getting very impatient. Of course, my loving wife, who was much more faithful and much more committed to letting God do things in God's time than I can ever wrap my brain around, kept reminding me that, you know, it's just, you have to be patient, you have to wait. It's a process. God's doing things, and we don't even have a clue what God's doing. I had no idea what was going on here all the time I was there. But obviously, I firmly believe that God was doing things here and doing things there to make everything work the way He wanted it to work, to come together.